The assignment was to come up with creative solutions to these kinds of topics, these topics that we had. One was to improve campus transportation options. The second one was to try to figure out how to decrease the 60% airline delay. And the third was, how do you optimize sustainability? In other words, how do we fix I-65 and all that we see there? So you guys met as groups last week and came up with these solutions. And now what I'd like you to do is tell your classmates what kinds of solutions you did come up with. We volunteered this group over here to be the first. Let me get you up on the group, on the board, and you'll take it as soon as you appear, okay? So just tell us what you did. Go ahead.
So we picked the improve the flights that are being delayed by 60% of the time. We came up with a lot of causes of being delayed, being stuff like weather, like the aircraft left late, flights being overbooked can cause delays because then you have problems boarding people. Problems boarding, pilots stalling on the checks of their airplane, and then having a faulty aircraft. The solutions that we came up with, whether there really wasn't anything you could do to change the delay, you can't really control the weather, even the weathermen can't control the weather. Aircraft leaving late, there isn't much you can do, depending on why your aircraft is leaving late. The flights being overbooked, you can solve that problem by selling only the amount of tickets needed to fill the plane. Problems boarding, looking at the boarding process and trying to streamline it in some way. I know that a lot of airlines already do this now, but there's always stuff that you can improve upon. And having a faulty aircraft, so like looking at the reports really carefully and pilots really taking the time to like look at what's wrong and have what is wrong fixed correctly.
The main problem that we want to talk about is the pilot stalling on the aircraft on the pre-checks, because right now that there's a disagreement with the union and the airlines, and they're really just trying to stall. And if they make the plane late, that costs the airline money, even if it's just by a minute. So that can really increase the 60%. So if you fix the problem with just like by paying the pilots more or just whatever the pilots want, then that percentage will really go down. So that's really all that we have.
Perfect. Very good. Very well done. So as you can see, it's as simple as that to do this whole thing. Do I have a group then, somebody else that wants to go ahead and go next? You guys decide, or I'll just pick a table. You guys got it? Thank you. Is that you guys? Perfect.
Okay, so we chose to improve transportation on campus, and our problem statement was the current transportation systems on campus are inefficient and should be more convenient for students and faculty to use. And here's some ideas that we generated. Buses having more routes, Uber exclusively for on-campus use, an on-campus tram system, developing a social website for carpooling for students on campus, more distance learning classes so not everybody's trying to pile on campus at 9:30, 10:30, stuff like that. And then a Segway sharing app.
So we narrowed down on two potential solutions. The first one would be the Segway sharing app. So the advantages of the Segway is that it saves more spaces, saves more space than a bike would. It also saves fuel as opposed to buses, so it would help us to reduce pollution on campus. It's a low investment since this is a crowdsourcing solution, and we have reach out stations wherever the Segways are parked, so they get charged when they are not in use. And the second potential solution could be an Uber exclusively for the campus. So this would have carpooling, which would save fuel, and this could be useful for relatively short distances as opposed to the normal Uber app. Yeah, that's it.
Very good. I don't think I would have ever thought of the Uber and the Segway as options for campus, but that makes sense as well. So I think I've pegged this group to go next. Hold on one sec. Let's get you up there. This is you guys.
All right. So the problem that we can All right. The problem that we came up with was student transportation. More specifically, there isn't a whole lot of parking passes, or there isn't a whole lot of convenient parking for those of us who live off campus, and those that are on campus that are C lot, they're extremely far away. So you think about Ross Aid or Discovery Lot. It's definitely not fun to walk to. Whenever it's hot and you're in a hurry.
Some constraints that we came up with while brainstorming our ideas were the time, overall cost, the lack of available open space closer to campus, the quick changeover without interfering with current parking operations, and insufficient for city or Purdue investment.
Okay, and then our ideas were basically to use the lots more effectively. We could make them into parking garages instead of just a giant lot. We were thinking about getting rid of some of the trees around some of the campuses to expand them. Just kind of basically just use our areas more efficiently. We also thought about changing the 2-hour parking limit to 3-hour parking so students have a chance to have their class and then talk to the teacher if they have any questions or anything. That kind of gives them a little more time to gather their stuff. We also thought about doing a C pass permit required to park on the street and leave it all day instead of just having the parking lot. So basically getting rid of the 2-hour parking instead and making it permit parking, or meter some of the 2-hour parking zones and waive the costs for commuters that are going into campus for like students and stuff. Or just change the CPass requirements in general so people can, I don't know, like students have a little better chance of parking, basically. But yeah, those are all our ideas.
Very good. There's your constraints. Thank you very much. Good job. Okay, I think I've tagged this group over there. There you go.
So our problem, like a lot of you, is transportation on campus. The things that I think people always try to do is, make cars have better parking, have better passes, make things work more together. And so, put more lights in to stop traffic, that way people can walk. And they have different ways of like rerouting traffic around campus, all those kind of things. But one thing I think that we came into with the problems on campus was?
Our solution, basically cleaning up how traffic goes. When people walk around, they cause a lot of havoc, and they just kind of walk wherever they want. We thought about rerouting the buses and then putting parking lots in for everybody to park at, and then a bus will come pick them up to kind of put everybody in the same spot. More signs. So our plan, we believe the solution is not to get rid of things or make more stops, but the opposite. We thought about putting roundabouts in instead of lights because we have 2 roundabouts on campus now currently, and they seem to work very well. They'd have to be bigger roundabouts because buses would have to get through them. But the flow would be smoother, I guess. And then, like I said, the parking lot with the bus pickup, and then they can get up on the roundabouts.
Very good. Thank you. And I don't know how many of you are aware of it, but the city of West Lafayette is actually planning, currently in the process of planning a route, basically, to make Purdue's campus foot traffic friendly, so that the traffic, they're right now talking about eliminating all of the main roads, so that basically it's a foot traffic campus. I don't know how that's going to go over, but that's what there's talk of right now in the area. So there are actually thoughts about this. I'm going to have these guys go next, and they're improving airport delays again.
All right, so we said that if there was a quick turnover of planes, well, that leads to delays during the destination transfer and inspection. And we said that people take too long to board and exit the planes. And
in some airports, lack of runways. There's lack of runways for the landing and takeoff. Planes are being used for back-to-back flights. And then obviously weather can delay the flight departure and arrival times, and a limited amount of individuals who can perform inspection of planes prior to takeoff.
Okay, so for our solution, we said that instead of using the same plane or the same planes for consecutive flights, you could kind of create two groups so that you alternate, so there's never delay for that. And then we also said expanding airports, of course, and adding more runways for landing and takeoff. And then there's no way to really control weather, but we said that you could create an app that would be more immediate, letting people know that their flights are delayed, so maybe you don't have to drive all the way to the airport if you have a delay.
Very good. Nice job. Very good. Thank you. We're going to go over there, and let me see if I can get this right. Let's see. That should be that one. You guys. Perfect.
All right. Our problem was to kind of disqualify the flight delays, 6%. There's a whole lot of ways we experimented with doing it, and one of the things that kind of helped with the situation is weather and things like that. So you just want to elaborate on that.
So we generated three random solutions. As odd as it sounds, we had barn animals, more runaways, and more plane mechanics. Barn animals, you know, it's already utilized by the Chicago of Midway. They use barn animals to trim their grass, and they save money on lawnmowers and green credits that we could utilize for, you know, putting down more de-icer on planes, helping to prepare for longer flights, and possibly if there's an oil spill, we don't have to pay as much. More runways, so having different colored lights along different colored runways, so maybe bus 50% in more than we could and 50% more out quicker. And make it easier for pilots to identify which ones they're landing on. And like I said, allows for more than one plane to be able to land at once. In regards to planes, maybe incentivize companies to bring in larger airplanes at one time so you can bus more people in, more people out, to get the flow going at an increased pace. And then have more mechanics and more inventory on site, so if there is a breakdown, you guys can get the planes going a lot quicker. And then our recommended solution is to add more runways and to, like I said, have more mechanical technicians and stuff like that, so the planes can get off the ground a lot quicker.
Okay. Thank you very much. Good job. Okay. So are you guys ready? Let's see. This should be you.
Okay, so we did our problem on campus transportation and the problems that it has. So we decided that most of the problems with transportation on campus is that people don't know how to use the transportation, and or there's lack of information or improper structures of the transportation. So the specific problems we indicated was inconvenient places of the bike share system. So we've noticed like that there's bike shares that aren't used, and there's also bike shares that never have bikes on them. The bike lanes do not connect, and they cause service center areas. So what we notice is like when walking to campus, bike lanes don't connect, so then the bikers don't know where to go, so then they run into other pedestrians. Lack of knowledge or fear of the bus system. I know I've rode the bus system like maybe 10 times because I don't know how to use it. And then non-existent understanding of how the bike shares work. I don't know how they work at all. So if they like send out an email or something to explain.
So some ideas we came up with that we could conduct an email and social media campaigns to educate students on the existence of the bike share. And we could also improve information about the bus loops on the smartphone app that everyone should get. And we could place information on the signs by the bus stops so people know the routes better and they could actually use the routes. And we could also integrate bike share information with the Purdue bus app so we could provide updated information of bike availability for students. And we could also connect the bike lanes to make it safer for students to bike around campus so they would actually, you know, use bike share more and wouldn't be worried about problems for that.
And so then just putting these all together into proposed solutions, it's really just focusing on not necessarily expanding on what we already have, because we think that Purdue has a pretty good groundwork. It's just being able to efficiently utilize all of the infrastructure that exists. So using Purdue social media accounts, using mass emails to students, and getting the word out about the existence and kind of the ease of use of some of these systems.
Very good. Thank you. So, I have a question. Is there currently no app that tells you what's going on as far as transportation on campus? Is there nothing like that? Yes?
There is a bus app.
Okay.
It's not called City Bus, or I don't know what it's called.
I had it my sophomore year.
Okay.
But it's not like called anything related to our bus system. It's like an off-the-wall name.
Okay.
So like to find it, it was really hard. And then like once you find it, like, it's like learning how to use it, because
okay,
nobody has it.
Okay.
So I think out of like all my friends, maybe two of them had it, and then out of the two that had it, one knew how to use it, and the other one just had
that
it on their phone.
Me,
okay. So did you have something?
I've got the app. It's called Double Map.
Yeah. Double Map?
Yep.
Okay.
And you can go on there and like select the different routes that you want.
Okay.
So like I've got like three routes pulled up that run halfway close to where I want to go. And I'll just try catching whichever bus I think is going to get there first.
Okay. So. Okay, very good. And who is it? Scott says that there is actually a Purdue.
There's a Purdue app, and it shows the bus system, and it also tracks where the buses are in the route.
Right, it does, but that one is extremely.
It's extremely what? Ineffective. Okay, so it never tells you where the map, where the bus really is. Okay, so we mainly have something to solve the bus problem, more or less, though it can be improved on. You guys have got campus parking as well, so go ahead.
Okay, so our main problem was that Purdue doesn't offer enough parking spaces throughout campus compared to the amount of new housing that Purdue is offering. So some of the brainstorming ideas we came up with were that the permits are only offered to people who live 1.5 miles off campus. There's too many residence halls and not enough parking garages. The grad students are taking all the parking garages, and we think that freshmen like shouldn't get parking permits, so that like allows for more like upperclassmen to get them.
Our proposed solutions are new parking garages in like the Purdue West area or at the co-rec. To revise the distribution method or amount of parking passes. Right now, it's they open it up to grad students, and then if there are any passes left over, they open it up to seniors, juniors, and then sophomores, and right now, it stops at grad students. So having a set number of permits for each level would be better, and then revising the parking permit policy. Or some campuses are currently looking into off-campus parking and shuttling people from that parking lot into campus. So looking for an area to have that sort of lot off campus.
Very good, thank you. Okay, is anybody else ready to go? You guys ready? Okay. Figure this one out. One, two. This will get you. Hold on one sec. Yes.
All right, so our problem was, like many of you, again, the airport delays, having 60% of flights being delayed. So we compiled a bunch of reasons. of those reasons were mechanical issues, weather, plane capacity, checking in your luggage, security, fueling of the planes, plane trafficking, more specifically within the trafficking of boarding the planes, as well as them taking off for liftoff, and a lot of people being understaffed at the airports as well. Further, of those we compiled, we focused on a certain ones, like within the employee staff, having more supervision among the employees to really like kind of hammer down on what they need to have in terms of like having a pre-checklist of what's going on. I'm not sure if there's a system where like they already have already of checking bags online. I think that would be pretty effective, so you can come in and just literally drop off your luggage at the airport and it's already checked in for you. And then again, more trafficking lanes and more flight options throughout the day among different airlines too.
So what we thought would be the best solutions is checking in online and checking your bags online, which would quicker the ticketing line and be able to make sure that the flight is always on time before you actually get to the airport with no delays. And that makes for the opportunity to make more efficient security lines so that people can get through security a lot quicker. Another option would be for more trafficking lanes, adding more runways for the plane so that they may lift off more than just one plane at a time and having more planes land at more than one at a time. And employee training would also be helpful for solutions, so that making sure that all employees are not slacking off, because there's so many employees out in the airport that you can't really keep track of everyone, so make sure that supervision is tight as well.
Very good. Thank you. You guys ready?
So we addressed the traffic issue again, and one of the biggest issues we've seen is you've got cars and buses and university vehicles and then just random people passing through. And the buses and the car mix causes one of the biggest delays, because buses stop every like 150, 200 yards, and everybody tries to cram over in the other lane to get around them.
So to go over some of our brainstorming ideas, first off, if we added some more levels to parking garages, instead of four or five levels, make it 9 or 10, double up on parking. Another thing is the moving sidewalks. I'm sure if you guys have been to an airport before, you've seen these. That definitely increase efficiency. One thing you can't rule out is the jetpacks.
I mean, you can't be sad on a jetpack. You can go wherever you want.
I'd give our engineer something to think about. I doubt IU would have that yet. close the section of the northwestern, pretty much the main streets on campus. That would be to pedestrian traffic. University vehicles would still be allowed on there. Buses would still be on there too.
We get rid of just the traffic that's passing through, so that way that's more streamlined.
All right. The next one would be a closed loop monorail system. I don't know, you guys, if you've ever been to Disney or a theme park like that. That's another way to really move a lot of people, and you'd also be able to keep your regular traffic moving too. And then also just a one-way traffic system on the major roads around campus.
So our proposed solution was implement a sky rail type system like you see here. Doesn't affect anything on the ground already. Purdue's pretty landlocked, so a lot of the other things that we try to do, just Purdue doesn't have the space to do. This way it's up in the air and it's unique to Purdue. I don't know of any other campuses, and I did a quick Google search. It didn't look really hard. Nobody else has this type of thing. You run it around all the same bus routes that currently go. So you run out to Purdue West, up into the Acres, out to Rossade, and then you could even have spinoffs, and you'll have a whole bunch of Skyrail type trains on the system. And it'll also probably attract more businesses and money coming into Purdue, because they can still get onto campus when they need to. That's it.
Very good. Very well done. Okay, I'm going to go this way first, back there. And I believe you guys. Yes, I'm sorry.
Okay, so we did campus transportation too. We had two main focuses, not just on and off campus, like to apartment buildings and stuff, but also like to building, because I know a lot of students that like will walk from like physics, well, won't walk from physics to electrical engineering, they'll take the bus, and I'm like, okay, really? Some of the ideas we came up with was like, I know a lot of apartment complexes have their own shuttles and stuff, like the Avenue, they have their own bus system. And then I think that like, well, we think that like dorms, if they had their own like bus system, maybe not like the city bus, but like little shuttle buses that would take students to their classes. And then we also came up with like skywalks. I know IUPUI has like a really good skywalk system, and this wouldn't affect the cars on the ground. So I feel like that'd be a really good idea. And then we already have tunnel systems at Purdue. They're just filled with storage right now. Maybe if they clean those out, we could use those, and then maybe obviously they have to improve the structure and safety hazards and stuff, but those are some of the ideas we came up with.
So a couple of probable solutions. The first one we had with the Purdue bus system. So basically Purdue would have like its own system that would run through all the buildings and stuff, couple of the apartment buildings and whatnot, just to make it a little more accessible and specific, whereas like the city bus goes around, you know, all over. So Purdue bus system works specifically on campus. And then also we're a private dorm business, so if somebody opens up like their own private bus system, doesn't have to be like a huge bus, but you know, like the minibuses they can get a hold of or whatever, that would basically provide access to each dorm, to each like the major popular apartment complexes and things like that. And then again, our last problem solution was the skywalks. Constructing those throughout the main buildings on campus gets people off the ground, keeps traffic flowing a little smoother, and gets students through classes a little bit quicker and whatnot.
Very good, thank you. Then we're gonna go with Alyssa and Erica. Let's see, let me make sure I get the right table. Should be there.
So we chose campus transportation also. We kind of narrowed it down, and we thought that the problem was more so that students are trying to get from point A to point B to like get to their classes, and we just like kind of inferred and like from our past experiences and like observing students, we see a lot of students like leave classes and they go and like get in their cars. So that's what we kind of thought the problem was. And some of the solutions we came up with is like putting a centrally located parking garage in the middle of campus. So that way the students could like drive to the parking garage and they wouldn't have to like keep driving everywhere else to get to classes. Change some of the current parking to C parking, remove State Street, build a large parking garage off campus, and then have monorails that bring the students to like campus, and then have like sensors in parking spaces so that like people will know like what spots are open so they don't have to like drive around campus to find a spot.
So our favorite solution was building a large multiple of a parking garage somewhere off campus, and then having three different monorail loops with different stops at the garage. And those three would take you to North, Central, or Southern campus, so you don't have to go just to one end and then have to walk all the way over to your classes. And then have bike racks at both the garage and the stop, so you have options of, okay, well, I don't want to bike all the way there, or leave your bike there and take it to the stops with you.
Very good, thank you. We're gonna go this way. Let me make sure I get you the right. Are you guys I-65? Yay, there you go, thank you.
So our problem that we did was I-65 is never in good condition. As a result of this, the road is under frequent construction. And as you know, in August, 50 miles of the road between Indy and Lafayette went down, causing crazy traffic delays, especially from people commuting. It went down the first weekend, so people commuting from, especially south of Indy to here, were affected. And then this is probably from severe weather conditions causing potholes and other things like that. Some ideas that we generated were more frequent maintenance and adding another lane the whole way to make the traffic flow a little better. And then redo the road with the material that will hold up better for cold and severe weather.
So our solution that we decided to go with was to redo the road with material that will hold up better during the cold and severe weather. Even though it'd be convenient while you're redoing the road, in the long haul, it will reduce the time that you have to go maintenance. As you notice, during the summer, driving around Purdue is not fun at all. There's actually an asphalt out there that's a porous asphalt that absorbs the water, so the roads aren't slick anymore, and it also kind of reduces the use of potholes as well. So that's it.
Very good, very good. I like that even knowing about the materials that there are some options out there. I think we're going that way next. Oh, that's you. Thank you.
So we did the campus transportation, and we thought weather was a big thing that affects how many people use the bus system and crowd it. So even when it's raining, it's hot, it's really cold, buses get overcrowded. And then the amount of students, more students over transportation options, we thought was a problem. And then students not knowing the bus routes or lack of knowledge, and then the amount of traffic that's out there due to other cars. So we thought the weather was the, we put that as our main problem, that students tend to do that.
So we have a couple ideas, like renting out longboards, because they are doing bikes, might as well do longboards. You know, people like longboarding, but then it won't do any difference during winter because it's slippery and no one's gonna, you know, longboard during winter unless you want to trip and fall. Opening the underground tunnels, because they're blocked, you might as well just open them and it's kind of easy, like just clear the things out. And then built more garages, but then we thought that it was, you know, a little hard to find the land because they have already building so much stuff right now. And then increase the bus size, like, but then in a way, how many times do we have to increase the bus size in order to accommodate all the students on campus? And also increase the bus frequency, but it's gonna be expensive because you have to hire bus drivers and then the gasoline and like the money that would, you know, cost to run the buses.
So we thought the best solution would be the underground tunnels, just to open those up for the foot traffic more on streets, then the buses could get around more, and then it also take care of like when it's weather, you don't have the problem with crowding buses. And then they'd also have to be improved to fit so we could travel through them.
Very good, thank you. How many of you are even aware of the fact that we have underground tunnels? Does anybody not know about the underground tunnels? I didn't know for my first year and a little bit here. And so I would, you know, go out in the snow and run around, and everybody finally looked at me and said, you know you can go underground to do this. And I kind of went, oh, yeah, sure, I knew that. I didn't know that. Okay, in the next group, right there, Danny and...
Okay, so ours obviously also is campus transportation. And obviously, like, weather is a factor. Everyone said that you can't control it. Some people have to go from, like, physics to, like, Bearing, and it's really far away, stuff like that. And then buses aren't always efficient. It really depends on the route and, I guess, the bus driver.
Some of the solutions we came up with were more parking lots, underground parking lots, so it's not an eyesore. People movers, moving sidewalks, or conveyor belts, whatever you call them, all over campus. Or golf cart shuttles from dorms to main campus, or across campus, because there's not really like, you can't really get across campus on a bus, you have to go all the way around. That kind of sucks.
So the solution that we came up with was to use the existing tunnel system and build new tunnel systems in such a way that we can produce two main lines with conveyor belts in them. So the existing tunnel system will support the new tunnel system. The new tunnel system, which will be the major lines that you can see in the picture, will have conveyor belts on which you can get on and get off easily, the two-way conveyor belts. So you literally, it's just once you get on, you fly by. This is better, this we thought was the most optimal solution because we already have an existing tunnel system that we can modify, and also that the conveyor belts means that weather is no longer a factor, and the internal buses that will be used within the campus can be eliminated for a large extent. Also the fact that once you're on the conveyor belt, like there's no waiting for anybody or any bus or tram or anything else. It's you and your timing's a lot. So that's why we thought it was an optimal solution. So yeah, it's the same point.
All righty, thank you. Has anybody not presented their solution?
Our problem was campus being overcrowded, so transportation amongst pedestrians, students not getting places. Campus is overcrowded, so transportation is slow.
There's too much driving traffic on campus.
And then there's limited parking for commuters.
One of our ideas or solutions was to change the bus routes, make them more efficient, improve the timing, because a lot of the timing is off on the buses. They don't arrive on time.
And more parking available for students. So if students have more parking, there'd be less fines giving students parking places that they don't need to be parking.
And also a car-free zone on campus, so only buses would be allowed. This would provide less traffic, less accidents, more accessible campus for students and pedestrians, and quicker bus routes.
And then more tunnels throughout campus, so that students wouldn't have to deal with the traffic, bad weather, and buses would be less crowded.
Very good. Okay. What about the other side of the table? While they're pulling that up, you guys have come up with some good ideas, and I like the creativity that you've included in your thoughts for the most part. Some of you have thought way outside the box, and I like that. And that's, again, back to the reason we did this project, when you go out into companies, they are looking for people who can be creative, who can look for solutions that may or may not be doable, but they may spark an idea for something else that could happen. And that's the goal of the whole creative thinking and creative movement, allowing you to use your youth and your brain power to come up with some new, different ideas and approaches to dealing with things. So we got our last group, and let's go ahead and have them do it. Go ahead, Keaton.
We went with the campus transportation problem. The main problems we identified were bikes creating too much traffic on the sidewalks, getting in the way of people walking. There's not enough parking spots for students specifically that are close to the campus buildings. The bus loops that we have in place right now, we think they take too long and they're not spaced out very well. They kind of get backed up right behind each other. And then the last problem we identified is the construction on campus right now creating really narrow pathways for walking and driving.
We came up with a couple potential solutions to those problems. The first being railings along bike lanes, kind of thinking of it like a bike highway, kind of right down the engineering mall and other main spots where it's kind of streamlining the bike traffic so you don't have to fight upstream with the walkers and vice versa. That would definitely make things more efficient. We talked about adding more parking and making the garages a little bit taller and then making them accessible to the normal students and kind of tying it in with an app where you'll be able to see where the availability on campus is for parking, whether it's in those garages or two-hour parking on campus. Maybe that's connected to the coin slots, the parking meters, so that you can know where that availability is. And then just more up-to-date, the bus app, so you can know where everything is. It's just, you know, better logistically tied together, so that.
So our final solution that we decided on was to create an app that helps students, instructors, and any visitors to find parking on campus. So they could have a sensor when they go into garages to see how many spots are still in there. That way you can have the count. So if there's like one parking spot left, you know. And then they could also use that to measure how many would be left to be open up to C students that have the C parking permit. So maybe like the top two or three levels could be receive permits instead of having to have their car parked all the way at Ross 8 or somewhere. And then also for the have them connected to the street parking as well. So making sure that spots are defined with the 2-hour parking instead of just having it like a free-for-all and having people take up two spots when more than one person could be parked there. And then creating a parking meter, but having it just like push up a button just to let them know that you're there, and that'll connect to the app to show that the spot is taken, but they're only allowed to be here for another hour or however long it would be. And then it would also help the police figure out who's been parking there for too long and is gone over their 2-hour limit. So
very good, thank you. And to that, it's kind of interesting because the other day I actually saw someone run out of their apartment or whatever and took a wet cloth out and, you know, took the chalk mark off. And so it's exactly, so having something that actually said this person's been parked at this location for this amount of time, you know, it's kind of one of those cheesy things, but it's a good idea. And the whole thing of the whole censored parking spaces, I don't know how many of you have ever flown into Nashville or Colorado, Denver. They actually have waiting stations that are censored so that you can pull in. And it triggers when you go in, and it gives you I think it's about a 15-minute countdown so that you can be in that space waiting for someone to arrive, and it's right outside the arrival stations. You can be in that space waiting for someone to arrive. The same kind of idea could be used here. I like the apps and stuff. Obviously, transportation and students getting around is our biggest concern because we are held up by that kind of thing. We walk a lot. I walk a lot. And it's kind of good. So I was laughing. I was thinking, okay, let's give all the students, any student who's willing to walk, a new Fitbit. and start it, you know, being a competition kind of thing, and at the end of the year you get whatever you get. So there are all kinds of different ways to look at these problems, and you guys have done a great job of coming up with some different solutions. I love the Uber for campus, the ride share kind of thing, an app that tells you where you are, where people that maybe live. How many of you have discovered that someone in your class lives right next door to you in the apartment or in the dorm or wherever? Many of you have probably found out that kind of thing. This whole idea, again, is looking at creative solutions. We chose kind of logistical situations for you to solve, and I think you've done a really, really good job of doing that.